Now, the question you're probably wondering is, will this thing start? Let's go find out. I figured since it's 10 degrees outside, actually negative 10 degrees, so it's a little chilly, it's about time for me to tackle this 1990 Chevy pickup. It's got a 454 in it, manual transmission. It runs good, but you can't start it. The starter got stuck, Bendix was thrown out, and the rear gear on the flywheel happened to chew it itself together and kind of mesh and metal filings and stuff. Basically, you can't start the truck. In order for me to fix that, I've got to take the transmission off, I got to take the flywheel off, and then there's a ring gear, I got to pull that off, put a new ring gear on it, put the flywheel back on, put the transmission back on, then the starter, I got to put a new Bendix in the starter, put it all back together, and it should be good to start every once in a while. So if we need it in cold weather, gas starts easier than diesel, we're going to use this truck. That's kind of the idea of what I'm gonna do. But isn't it just beautiful? I mean, the paint's slightly faded. There's no dings. I mean, absolutely no dings or scratches or anything on the truck. I mean, it's immaculate. This here is a one of a kind truck. I think they only made like maybe, I don't know, a couple million of them. But I want to see this thing back to life. I think this is necessary for us to use it again. Isn't it just beautiful? I mean, look at this. You don't get that anywhere else. I guess it's about that time for me to stop talking work, huh? All right, let's go to work. In order for me to do this, I've got to take the drive line off, the front and back. I think I might be able to leave this transmission up in here, but shift it back enough to get that flywheel out, or I might just pull it all the way out. We'll see how it is, but I gotta take the shifter up off, up above inside the cab, take off the bolts to the bell housing, and then, yeah. So basically just do some of that stuff. But in here, you can see where it's all chewed up. The ring gear, starter, didn't like each other at the point, so. Now what I gotta do is I gotta go up inside the cab. I should have did this while the truck was down on the ground, but I'm gonna go up there and I'm gonna try to take out that shifter. And if I can take it out, then I can move the transmission backwards. I'm gonna try to keep the transmission in the truck. If I can't, then I'll pull it out, but just see how far we can go. Oh, there we go. That would be sweet, wouldn't it? To have a truck this lifted in the air, I could climb over anything just like a Prius. Would you look at that, I remembered. So they got this little sweet deal where if you push it in and you turn it counterclockwise, this pops out, and then I believe, there you go, shifter's out. That's all I had to do. What I got going on here is I've got a transmission jack here, and I'm going to let the truck down just a little bit so that I can strap it to this to lift it up off the transmission mount and pull it back just a little bit and then secure it in there. And hopefully I have enough room to reach in there and take the clutch off and pull the flywheel. But I have a feeling I'm just gonna need to yank this thing out of here. Well, we'll see. We'll see if I need to do it or not. But yeah, it's gonna be a little interesting. I'm gonna go ahead and just pull the transfer case off and move it aside and get it out of the way, because I don't think there's enough room for me to pull the transmission back. So I figure the best thing for me to do right now, take that off, move it out of the way, and then I can get the transmission. I'll probably just pull the transmission down. I've actually not watched a video on how to do this, so I'm probably doing this wrong, but eh, whatever. I'm just gonna do it. We did this a while back, but I just don't remember what we, you know, there's so many things going on, it's hard to keep track. But anyways, that's what I'm gonna do. Take this thing, move it off to the side, and keep plugging away. Well, the engine's free from the transmission. There's no bolts holding it. I just have to wiggle the transmission backwards, take it off the input shaft, and I guess pull it off, right? And then I'll probably raise the truck up or something. I'll figure it out. Something like that. I really wish Nick was here to hold the camera. That'd be nice. Well, I got the transmission out. It's just sitting right here. I'm gonna go ahead and pull that pressure plate off. So this here is a pressure plate, and then right behind it is a clutch. And the clutch, I'll tell you what, I'll explain that when I get it all apart. How about that? Okay, now that I have this all apart, I'm gonna quickly explain the purpose of everything for those that don't understand why I'm doing this or have no idea. This is called a flywheel. It mounts the back of your motor. Ooh, this thing's cold. Anyways, the motor's sitting here, so whatever speed the motor's spinning, this is gonna spin that. You have to transfer that energy to the wheels somehow. How do you make something that's spinning to connect with something that's not? You have to have something that can take abuse so it can slip. That is the purpose of this right here. This is called a clutch, the clutch plate or whatever. It's called, it's got ceramic material of some sort, and it will connect to your transmission, okay? Well, it's sitting in here, and when you have the pressure plate, which is this right here, it's bolted up. And after it's all bolted up, it's gonna connect and everything's solid, so it's all spinning. Well, when you put your clutch in to put your vehicle in neutral, or basically to stop the power of the engine spinning, it will take that pressure plate, lift it up, and then this can spin freely. When you release your clutch, that pressure plate comes back down, mashes to this together, and it makes it all one unit. Because you got to find some way, every time you shift your gear, you got to put it in neutral, let this thing spin freely so that you can shift your gear and then lock it back up. The worst thing you can do on a clutch is slowly ease into it. You don't want to just do that. You want to ease into it to a certain point, but you want it to grab fast. The reason for is the more time you have slipping, the more wear and tear. We are already replaced this clutch like a couple years back, and it literally does not have much use on it. It's basically brand new. You can even see where we had the flywheel turned down. And when I say turned down, we had, there's a wear mark that used to be in this flywheel. So we had it cut down with a diamond blade actually, so it's all one flat surface. That way it can mesh to your clutch and bond together. So that's the purpose of that. The whole reason why I took all this apart was not because of the clutch. It's called the ring gear. When your engine stopped, you need to find a way of starting it. And that's what this is for right here. This is called a starter. The starter has a little gear on it. As the starter engages, you turn the key, it clicks over like this, it flings it out, then hits that ring gear, rotates your engine, and your engine starts firing up. This is called a Bendix. The Bendix actually got stuck and it was just chewing on your flywheel. Well, it did a little bit of number on this side right here. So this whole side right here got all chewed up. Well, if you don't have any way of converting or transferring the energy from your starter to your flywheel and connecting that, you can't start your vehicle. So your vehicle's dead. We could pull start that vehicle anytime we wanted because it's a manual, but that's, you gotta have another vehicle to do it. So it just sat there. We haven't done anything with the truck. The truck's still a good truck, but in order for us to use it, I have to change this little ring here and put it on. What's amazing about this, and it just, I'm just amazed that it can take that abuse, is there's no welding required. There's nothing to keep it on except for friction. I will heat this gear, or the ring gear here, I'll heat it up with a torch, or I might actually just cut it, tell you the truth, and pop it off. To install these, you'll see me take a torch and I'll heat this up really hot, and then I'll set it above it and I'll take a hammer and tap, 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 and it just falls right over. The reason for the heat is it will take the heat and expand that ring, and metal will expand if you didn't know that, and it will fall back down right into place, and when it cools, it shrinks. Well, when it shrinks, let's just say it sticks on there pretty good. So if you ever have a problem with this going bad, you can just replace this ring gear instead of buying the whole entire flywheel. That basically sums up the gist of what I'm doing. And if you want to just make it simple, I need this to make it go. I'm gonna go ahead and take this ring gear off. Fun. For those that might be wondering, how far do you put that ring gear on? Like, you might think, well, is there gonna be a way to stop it? Yes, there is. They have a little tiny groove right here that has been machined down where there's a little lip, so I can't put that ring gear on any further than it needs to be. So all I gotta do is heat that sucker up and then tap that sucker right on. It's like brand new. Well, now I gotta put this back on. I'm gonna put some Loctite in the threads on the bolts and torque them down to, I believe, 80 foot-pounds of torque. I gotta look it up and make sure, but I think it's about that. And then put the pressure plate on, and then there's a tool, and I'll show you how you use that tool and the reason for it. But anyways, let's go ahead and put this thing back on. The tool that I'm gonna show you, it's gonna be interesting because I gotta show you this way. There we go. This here is actually a little key, okay? The purpose of this is to center, when you put the clutch on, you gotta center it straight. So when your input shaft of your transmission, it's gotta line up and go through these splines. You see how they got little keyways cut on them? You have to have this centered. Doesn't mean that you have to have this tool. You can use sockets, you can use extensions, you can use other ways, or if you have a lathe, you can mill down something and make something centered. Or if you're really, really good, which I'm probably not, you can center it up just by using your finger or your eyes, but the chances of getting it perfect, I don't think that's gonna happen very often. You might get lucky. So that with this piece, you stick it in, just like so, and then when you get it in there, you put it up inside, set it up, put your pressure plate on, bolt it up, pull the keyway out, and you're centered. At least that's what I'm gonna try to do. Now that I got that torqued on there, I'm gonna go ahead and put this back in the toolbox until I need it for another day. It's amazing how often you use these things because they work for different applications. Or if you just want a chew toy like me, every once in a while I need to gnaw on something for my stress level. But now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take the starter and I'm gonna start putting the new Bendix on it, and then I'm gonna mount the starter up there and try to get the clearance set right now before I put the transmission on. I've never done it that way, but I'm gonna try it. And if I can get it to work out well, then score, but if not, well, then I'll just do it afterwards, but let's go do the starter. Now that I got it apart, I put the new Bendix on, and this one wasn't really bad, but it was wore off on the point here. I'm already this far in. Instead of taking the transmission back off, I figured why not change it so I shouldn't have the same problem again. It's just not worth saving a few dollars just by not changing this piece. So long term, changing this piece should keep us from having the same problem. How this works, for those that don't know, and if you really want to know more about it, you can find some other video on YouTube that'll explain it a lot better than me. But as you energize the starter, you have a thing called a solenoid. It's got a little plunger in it. As you energize it, it will throw a lever, which then throws this little doohickey deal. Then that means it moves this doohickey deal and it starts your motor. Long story short, as this rotates, it flings this out, that catches the ring gear on the flywheel, cranks your motor over, and bing, bang, bada boom. So that's kind of the gist of it. I'm gonna put this back together, throw it on there, and keep working. But if you really wanna know how it works, find a different video that explains it a whole lot better than me. Inside the starter, as you energize the starter, it sends electricity to what they call brushes. These are the brushes right here. They energize the starter, and you've got magnets in here, which creates a field, and then the starter wants to rotate one direction, creates a lot of torque. It flings the ring gear, or the Bendix, out, which then connects the ring gear, starts your motor. So this is kind of what it looks like in here. Well, I'd say I guess I'm ready to put the transmission back in. I actually decided I'm gonna hold off on putting the starter on right now. I'll shim it later, you can do that. I think it's just gonna be in the way while I'm putting everything up in there, but let's put it back in there, see how well that goes. Hopefully it goes easier. After inspecting everything underneath there, it looks good, where I'd say let's put the transmission back in. No point of just having it sit there and not being used, right? So let's go do it. Now that I have the transmission up here, what I did is I went in the cab, I put the shifter in, locked the transmission in a gear so I can go behind the transmission and turn the shaft so that it'll spin the spline shaft in here to line up with the clutch, because you got to get that lined up. I can see right now it's going cockeyed if you look at the way the engine and the transmission's at. So I got to rearrange a little bit, kind of push and prod, and I got to try to somehow hit inside that hole that's in the clutch and line up all those splines. It might take a little bit, but it's in there. I mean, we're just about to turn the key and start it up, but maybe not quite that soon. But we're making progress is what matters. As you can tell, I got the transmission in there. The engine and transmission are not quite lined up correctly. I gotta wiggle it around a little bit. But now what I gotta do is I gotta try to get the spline shaft off the transmission to line up in the clutch splines. What I did is I went inside the cab, put the shifter back in the transmission, locked it into a gear so that way I can spin the back of the transmission and it'll spin this input shaft and then I can try to get it lined up to the clutch. Just gotta keep working on it and slowly, finally, surely, it'll go right in. I went ahead and took the transmission jack and I've already got a support in the back of the transmission. This exhaust here is holding the front of the transmission. It's really not too heavy, so it'll be fine for right now. And it really can't go anywhere because part of the input shaft is actually in the clutch a little bit. But what I'm gonna do is take this jack, move it to the engine, and tilt the back of the engine up a little bit and get these lined up pretty square. So I'll put the camera down and you can see it. Now that it looks like it's pretty lined up, I can go from the back of the transmission, turn the shaft a little bit, take a bar, and slowly pull it forward, and hopefully it'll just pop right in. That actually went together pretty easy. I only have two bolts in the bell housing to the engine just to secure it. And then what I'm gonna do is take this jack, move it back, jack the back of the transmission up, put the transmission mount back on, and then I can get this table out of here and I can lift the hoist up and it'll be easier to work on. Then I have to finish putting the bolts around on the top. Yeah, it's coming together pretty easy. That wasn't too bad, right guys? Let's do it. I'm ready to put the starter on. What I have to add is shims. And the reason for is if you have the starter too tight against the block, your starter will hit the ring gear and bind up and cause wear and tear, or it might not even engage. It can get the starter stuck, and then while your engine's running, the starter's running, which basically wears out your starter and ring gear. So we don't want that to happen. I'm gonna add these shims. I'm gonna put two of them in. They're different thicknesses. This one's 40 thousandths and 20 thousandths. So I'm gonna do 60 thousandths right now. And it seems like a lot. I'm gonna try it, start it, and if it works well, then I'll leave it. If not, I can always take out one. I have another one that I can add to it. But that's the purpose of shims, to space that ring gear away from your Bendix. Go put this thing on. Starter's put back in. I got the cover plate for the bell housing in, and then hooked up your clutch. And this has actually got a hydraulic clutch. So it uses a brake line that goes up to pedal. It's got a master cylinder and then a slave cylinder. And as you push it, applies pressure, your clutch starts working. So yeah, I went ahead and drilled a little bit bigger hole just so I could look in there and get it lined up because I couldn't seem to get that pin lined up. I know that's not the right way to do it, but this is a farm truck, so who cares, right? As long as it runs. And plus, more holes means more character, right? That's basically what I did right there, is added character. Now that that's done, everything is hooked up on the front. All the bolts are tightened around the bell housing and just bonked my head, felt great. Now the next step is I gotta put your transfer case in, which is this sucker right here. Ooh, it's leaking oil, fun. It's gonna be greasy, but I'll lift it up, put it in there, and we're getting close. I went ahead, put the drive lines on. I checked the fluids, had to add some, and everything else is back to normal, so it should be good to go. I'm gonna lower it down, put a battery in it, and try starting it. Isn't it just beautiful? Literally, I mean, the truck is just immaculate. If you're going to prom and you need a vehicle, we got one for you. Just saying. I mean, throwing it out there. If somebody's going to prom and they want to take this thing, you can take it. So, yeah. For those that don't know, I'm dyslexic, which means I struggle with reading. Lucky for me, there's a app called Audible that has a huge selection of audiobooks. We actually sit on the tractors for many, many hours, and every once in a while, it's nice to just sit there and listen to fun audiobooks. And actually, there's one I've been meaning to listen to for quite some time now. And being leg arms, it's only fitting that I listen to a book, Get Big Arms Now, by Lee Elbois.
But even when you don't have a DNA structure that spells tree trunk-sized arms, it's still possible to maximize the potentials of what you inherited before you devote the remaining years of your life doing endless sets of dumbbell curls to get your own big guns. There's actually more to getting bigger arms than isolating that two.
By the way, that's the most awkward way to put a battery in, but it works. Start listening with a 30-day Audible trial. Choose one audiobook or two Audible originals, absolutely free. Visit audible.com/WelkerFarms or text WelkerFarms to 500-500. That's audible.com/WelkerFarms or text WelkerFarms to 500-500. Now, the question you're probably wondering is, will this thing start? Let's go find out. Look at that! And let's see, is it going to gear? Ooh, we're moving, guys. Now we can do burnouts. Lots and lots of burnouts. Oh, look at this. You hear that? Yeah, that's a 454. That's pretty beat. But it runs, that's all that matters. That's pretty sweet, guys. I got it done. It's running. That's a good sign, right? If you enjoyed what you saw and you appreciate what we do of just miscellaneous projects, you never know what's gonna come up, please click the subscribe button. And that's somewhere either in this corner or that corner or somewhere on your screen. So if you wanna locate that, I would very much appreciate that. Not only me, but Welker Farms. And make sure you click that little tiny bell. For those that don't know what that is, the little bell there, it'll notify you when we have a new video. So the next time there's a new video, which is usually Wednesdays and Saturdays, unless there's complications, which happen once in a while, there's always gonna be at least two videos a week to one video a week. And if there's not gonna be a video of the week, well, I guess you're gonna not watch us, which might be good for you guys, because we're probably annoying and so forth. But guys, thank you so much. And it's nice to have one less thing in the back of my mind, knowing that I have to finish it and fix it or repair it. I don't have to do it. Okay, guys. God bless, and you take it easy.